Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, John Russell and I have a report on the effects of nickel mining in Indonesia. Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith teach some useful words for talking about U.S. presidential campaigns. Then they present today's lesson of the day. But first, this story.
Indonesia aims to be the world's top nickel supplier. But its efforts to produce nickel have seriously harmed the country's forests, nonprofit groups say. Indonesia is the world's third most rainforest-covered country, home to giant forest flowers and rare wild animals such as orangutans and elephants. Indonesia also has the largest reserves of nickel in the world. The metal lies in shallow deposits in the rainforest. Mining it is easy when the rainforest is cut down. Until recently, Indonesia mostly sold its nickel deposits in untreated form. It did not have factories to process the metal. Unprocessed nickel sells for less than the processed product. 10 years ago, Indonesian officials decided the country should stop selling its resources at such a low cost. Instead, officials said Indonesia would process the metal so it would sell at a higher price. This would result in more job openings also, officials said. A large nickel processing project began. Indonesian President Joko Widodo pushed the project further by building nickel factories, or smelters, near electric vehicle battery factories. In addition to the new nickel plants, coal power plants were built also to serve the new industrial sites.
More than 740,000 square kilometers of Indonesian rainforest have been logged, burned, or degraded since 1950, reports the nonprofit research group Global Forest Watch. But at the sites where developers are building these smelters, the surrounding forest disappears twice as fast, a new study by the Indonesian nonprofit Origa says. The new study of rainforest loss, based on government data, shows deforestation rose from an average of 33 square kilometers around each nickel processing plant or smelter to 63 square kilometers. Indonesia plans to build as many as 22 new plants. If plans go through, deforestation will likely greatly increase. The damage to the environment is devastating, said Timer Manurung of Origa. Rivers are polluted, mangroves are cut to develop smelter areas, coastal areas and coral are being damaged by the smelters. The waste from coal power plants is another problem, he said. The Associated Press verified the methodology used in the Origa report.
The area of Weda Bay is now one of the world's largest nickel production centers. Smelters and coal-fired power plants burn to process nickel ore into material for batteries and steel. The village of Lelilef Sawai is now surrounded by the Weda Bay Industrial Park. There, the deforestation and its effects are clear. Local farmer Librek Loha remains in Lelilefsoai, refusing to sell the land he has taken care of for 40 years. Now orange dust often covers his plants, and clean water is often lacking. The plants also grow more slowly, he said. From his land, he can hear building sounds and see bright orange material flow into the sea. Research shows landslides are far more likely in deforested areas. Max Sigoro, 54, is a traditional hunter and farmer. Bright lights and noise from construction scare the deer he used to hunt at night. He says he has lost nearly all the means he had to earn a living since the industrial park's growth. PT Indonesia Weda Bay officials declined to speak to the Associated Press. The company says it has planted more than 10 square kilometers of new trees. It says it plays an active part in supporting the living standards of local people, offering economic development. And the industrial zone meets all environmental standards, PT Indonesia Weda Bay says. The company also says it works to protect water and has launched coral and mangrove planting programs. The Weda Bay project is just one of the industrial parks criticized by locals nearby. An industrial park on the island of Borneo and other projects in North Maluku are also under community protests. Perhaps related to these public objections, European companies may be losing interest in nickel from Indonesia. In recent weeks, the French mining company Eramet and German chemical giant BASF announced they were canceling plans to build a $2.6 billion nickel plant in Indonesia. Indonesia has been seeking to work more with Tesla, which uses twice as much metal in its total production of batteries than the next highest auto competitor. The amount of nickel Tesla used in 2023 was up a third over the year before. Only 13% came from Indonesia last year. But Tesla's 2023 impact report noted Indonesia 18 times and warned the country's nickel will be very important. Tesla did not answer an AP email requesting information about its use of nickel from Indonesia and deforestation. Questions to Indonesia's Ministry of Environment and Forestry, Coordinating Ministry of Maritime and Investment Affairs, and Ministry of Energy and Natural Resources also went unanswered. I'm John Russell.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.
Every 4 years, the United States holds an election for the president in November. This lesson aims to help teachers and learners understand the political processes and expressions used during the election campaign. Let us begin with the expression political party. In elections, parties organize candidates who share party members' ideas about how government should operate. They try to win elections to gain and keep political power. There are two major political parties in the U.S. They are the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. There are other small political parties at the national level. These include the Libertarian and Green parties.
Each of the U.S. states and territories holds votes early in the election year. In many states and territories, these votes are called primaries, You may know the word primary as an adjective, meaning happening or coming first, as in primary school. When speaking of elections, it is a noun, but it has a similar meaning. It is the first election in a voting process that takes place over 1 year. You might also hear the term caucus. A caucus is also a kind of election, but it is held privately by the party and usually does not involve state election officials or equipment. The Iowa caucus was for a long time the first presidential contest during an election year. In a primary or a caucus, voters choose the party's candidates for local and state offices, as well as for national offices. The candidates who get the most votes become the candidates for the election in the fall. Primaries can be open or closed. Anyone can take part in an open primary election, even members of another party. Only registered party members can vote in a closed primary.
In some states, voters choose delegates in the primaries. State party organizations have different rules for choosing them. Delegates are people who will attend their party's convention or general meeting. When a delegate is elected to choose a particular candidate, we say the delegate is pledged to the candidate. To pledge is to promise something.
Each party holds a national convention, a large meeting where the delegates officially nominate the candidate that the party supports for the presidential election. The verb nominate means to officially choose someone as a candidate for a position. You will hear some other forms of the word in election news.
To describe the process of having the delegates choose a candidate, we use the noun form nomination. At the convention, the candidate who gains the majority of delegates is called the nominee. The nominee gives a speech to accept the nomination.
The party platform is a statement of the ideology of the party and its candidate. At the party convention, the organizing committee shares its platform. The platform is a statement of the policies that the party hopes to put in place during its candidate's term in office.
Presidential candidates travel the country speaking to voters at a series of events called rallies. Reporters use the expression campaign trail to describe these events. This is a metaphor for progressing along a path toward a goal. The election campaign is sometimes called a race, another metaphor comparing the election campaign to a sporting competition.
Part of the campaign process is for the candidates to debate each other. These are televised events where a reporter asks questions that interest the public and gives each candidate a limited time to answer them. The form of the political debates is not the same as traditional academic debates, where teams compete under clear rules and time limits.
Presidential candidates and others who run for public office must find money to pay for those rallies, television advertising, and campaign workers. A common way to pay for a campaign is to ask for money. People who give to a candidate are donors. The Federal Election Commission makes rules about how much, when, and how donations can be made.
Researchers get the opinions of voters in an effort to guess or predict the results of an upcoming election. They do this with polls or public opinion studies. This word has two meanings in the elections. One is where a researcher might ask you about your party affiliation and which candidate you plan to support in a telephone call. Your party affiliation is the party you are registered with or that you support. The other meaning of poll is the place where you go to vote on election day. We can also use polling place. Schools, religious centers, and public buildings can be polling places. In them, voters cast their ballot secretly. That means they fill out their ballot without pressure from others in the room and turn in their ballot to be counted by poll workers. In the last two election years of 2020 and 2022, people could send in their ballots by mail. But polling places remain important for processing and counting ballots.
Now that you have some of the expressions used to talk about the presidential campaign, you should use them with some care. It is not normal to ask someone what party he or she is a member of, although many people will offer that information freely. In some situations, such as among close friends, you will hear Americans talk about the candidates and voice their opinions openly. But when talking with a new acquaintance or a stranger, it is best to avoid asking about political affiliation. Also, know that some workplaces have rules against political activity. And in government, most political activity is not legal, although people often share their opinions. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
Jill Robbins is here now to talk a bit about vocabulary and word stress. Thanks for being here, Jill.
I'm always glad to talk with our podcast listeners.
I was wondering if we could talk about one of the words you mentioned in this lesson, delegate.
Yes, as we explained in the lesson, delegates are people who will attend their political party's convention. A delegate is elected to choose a particular candidate.
And can you explain more about the pronunciation of this word?
Yes, it is important to know that this noun has a related verb, to delegate, and there is a pronunciation difference.
So the noun delegate has stress on the first syllable, del.
And the verb form, delegate, has what we call secondary stress on the last syllable. It's not quite as strong as the first syllable, but it is enough to make the vowel sound change. And this is something that happens in other words in American English.
So the noun form just has stress on the first syllable, delegate. But the verb form also has a little stress on the last syllable, delegate. Thanks for being with us today, Jill, and thanks for explaining a bit about U.S. presidential elections.
It's always a pleasure, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Jill Robbins, and I'm joined by Andrew Smith. Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Jill.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
In a recent lesson of the day, we explained the differences between the verbs talk and speak. Today, we compare the verbs tell and say. We'll be listening to some of Lesson 22, Level 2 of Let's Learn English, to give some examples of these verbs.
You know, we often get emails from our audience asking about how to use these two verbs. At first glance, it seems they should work the same way, as they have the same meaning. But that's not the case. So I'm sure this will be very helpful. Tell us more, Andrew.
Okay. Here's the main idea to help your English. We put indirect object pronouns, or nouns, directly after the verb tell. Here's some examples.
Tell me the truth. Tell me the truth. Tell her the answer. Tell her the answer. Tell them what we said. Tell them what we said.
But with the verb say, we can't put those pronouns directly after the verb. Listen to Andrew give these examples.
She said to me, what did he say to her? Say to them.
Did you hear the difference between tell and say? With the verb say, we must use the preposition to before the pronoun. And most of the time, we don't even use indirect object pronouns like in this example.
He said that I need to finish the job by tomorrow.
Just to be clear, the pronoun I is a subject pronoun. The pronoun me can be either an indirect object pronoun or an object pronoun. Now, let's listen to the beginning of Lesson 22 of Level 2. In Lesson 21, Anna visited a store that sells art and objects found in the trash, or garbage. Now, Anna has tried to make art or special objects from the things she found. Try to listen for the difference between the verbs tell and say.
Welcome to class, Anna. I can't wait to see your trash. Oh, okay. All right. It's a net with a, oh, that's got a hole in it. Oh, tell me about that.
This net said to me, Anna, I used to catch stuff. I don't anymore. So use me, Anna. That's what it said. It said, use me, Anna.
Okay, so it's a plastic helmet.
This plastic helmet said, Anna, hey, Anna, find me a head.
Okay, and a broken toy.
This broken toy said to me, it said, Anna, help me find fun. Help me, Anna, is what it said.
Anna, this stuff is not saying anything to you or me or anyone. It's what we like to call in the business garbage.
We heard Sue say,
tell me about that.
And we heard Anna say,
this broken toy said to me, it said, Anna.
You can hear how Anna used the preposition to after the verb say.
And of course, the objects don't really talk to Anna. Anna just means that she was interested in the objects in a special way. As we explained in our previous podcast lesson, we can say that the objects spoke to her.
And notice that the past tense of say is pronounced said. You can remember this pronunciation by thinking of words that rhyme with said, such as red and head.
And what about the past tense of tell? Let's listen to more of lesson 22 to hear that verb.
Anna, what happened? I told you to wait for me.
Actually, you told me not to start without you.
The verb tell changes to told in the past tense. It sounds like Anna had some problems following directions in the class.
She sure did. Our listeners should really watch the video to see just how badly Anna followed directions.
Yeah, I think it's pretty funny. Anna ends up with pieces of paper glued all over her.
Okay, now we're going to move to the last part of our lesson. To learn how to use the verbs tell and say correctly, it can be helpful to simply hear several examples. So, Jill and I are going to read the following chant, which is kind of like a poem. Are you ready, Jill?
Ready.
Okay, here's the chant. I can tell you, and you can tell her. She can tell them, and they can tell him.
He can tell us, and then we will learn, if everyone said the same thing you did.
But if he says something we did not say, then we will know that something's astray.
Astray just means wrong, or not really right.
I can tell you, and you can tell her. She can tell them, and they can tell him.
And if he tells us the same thing we said, what I told you is what you told her, and what she told them is what they told him.
Isn't it great when everyone listens? That way you don't need to say it again.
But maybe this poem's a little bit tricky. I think they just might need to hear it once more.
And that's exactly what rewind is for.
Okay, I get what you mean. Now let's continue before I turn gray.
No comment on that, so take it away.
Now we will tell you just what to say to family and friends and those who will listen.
You can learn English by starting today with programs we make here at VOA.
Our website is learningenglish.voanews.com.
And remember, you can write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com. You can ask us questions or comment on our lessons. Tell us what you think about our programs. Or tell us something about yourself and what you enjoy.
We hope you enjoyed today's lesson about the verbs say and tell, and Anna's effort to make treasure out of trash. Thanks for listening. Say goodbye, Andrew.
Goodbye, Andrew.
Very funny. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.